Let's imagine you're making a game with a character who can fire at enemies. We want to give this character upgrades that alter their shots. Something like damage multipliers are a really straightforward way to do this, but I'd like to explore an alternative, modular approach. Enter the strategy pattern. But before we apply this to a game, let's start with a simple example. You have a list of numbers, and this list of numbers can have any type of number. Negative numbers, zero, decimals. So let's say we want to filter what numbers are in this list, and let's say that we don't want even numbers. A simple way is to loop over this list, check if the number is even, and if it is, remove it. Let's say we come back to this and we want to filter out negative numbers. That's really easy, just change the condition. Or later we come back and decide we want to remove all non-whole numbers. Again, that's pretty easy. This is super simple, and anything more would almost certainly be over-engineering. But let's explore something a little bit more modular anyways. So we'll start with a class, and I'll call this one numFilter. Now, because we're going to be working in GDScript and it doesn't support interfaces, we're going to stick with classes. But if you're using a language like C#, I would highly recommend using interfaces instead. But for now, we'll just use classes. Inside of this class, we'll have a method called isFiltered. This takes in the number and returns true or false based on whether or not it gets filtered out. By default, we'll return false. We can imagine this like a base filter, where we don't want to filter any numbers out. Then, for our first filter, we'll extend that class and call it evenNumFilter. For this filter, we'll just take in the number and return true if the number's even. Similarly, we can do the same for negative and decimal. And then if we head back to where we were doing the loop before, outside of the loop, we can create this filter. And instead of just using the condition in the loop, we can instead pass the number in through our filter method. So for example, right here, we're sorting out all even numbers using the class. Then if we want to change the filter, all we have to do is change which class we're creating. Now, where this really shines is if we place all of this code inside of a function, and that function will take in the filter as an argument. Because we extended all our filters from the same class, we can use this generically. Then elsewhere in our code, where this function is called, we can pass in our own filter from outside. So what's the point? Well, let's say I come back to this later and I want to filter out all numbers that are multiples of 5. The cool thing is this loop section is feature complete. So all we have to do outside is create a new numFilter and pass that into the function. Now for this example, is this overkill? Yes. So why would we use it? Well, in this case, it really doesn't make much sense to generalize all of this code. In fact, we've taken our 5-line function and expanded it to about 20 lines. But let's imagine a case where we're filtering units in something like an RTS game. Or, like our example from before, we're applying upgrades. Now, even though our example used a filter, strategies aren't limited to that. For example, instead of a filtered function, we could have a function that takes in a unit, gives them upgrades, and then you can string these strategies together like an assembly line. And that's exactly what we're going to do. So let's move over to Godot and we can explore how that works in action. But before we swap over, I want to mention that the project I'm using in this video is open source and on GitHub. Alongside that, there is a C# only version with minor differences like using interfaces instead of classes. All of the code is heavily commented, so if you want to learn GDScript and you know C# or vice versa, all you have to do is search the two code bases for the same comment and you can see how GDScript and C# approach the same problem. And for this project, all of the assets were sourced under the Creative Commons license. And the project is set up in such a way that you can use it as a template or for prototyping, so long as you give credit. There's more information on the GitHub page, so I would recommend giving that a read and seeing if it's something that you're interested in. All right, let's hop into Godot now. And inside of Godot, we're working with this project. We can see that we can spawn enemies, and it does 5 damage to shoot them, but after I pick up the upgrade, it goes up to 10, and by default it doesn't pierce, but once I pick up the piercing upgrade, it does. And of course the speed upgrade changes the speed of the bullet. So the way we're doing this hinges mainly on the base bullet strategy class. We have this class base bullet strategy that extends resource. These two fields are purely visual, but here we have this apply upgrade function. This is the strategy function we talked about earlier, where it takes in the spawned bullet and applies any upgrades we need. By default, it does nothing, but for example, in the damage bullet strategy, we take in the bullet and add 5 to its damage. Since this is a resource, we can also export variables and change them later. We'll come back to this. Now, as for how the player actually uses these, we can see that we store a list of the base bullet strategy on the player. And when the weapon gets fired, after we've already created and added the bullet to the tree, we loop over all of the upgrades and call the apply upgrade function, passing in the spawned bullet. As for adding the upgrades, we have this area2D that when it collides with the player, adds its currently stored upgrade to the player. And we can change this upgrade up here in the inspector by selecting this and adding a new bullet strategy. And while we could do it through the inspector, we would have to reset up things like textures every time. So instead, we can actually save it directly to the project by creating a new resource. For example, I can create a new resource and specify that I want a speed bullet strategy. I'll go ahead and give this a name, and opening it up, we can change the texture in the upgrade text like we saw earlier, and even change the speed increase variable like I mentioned earlier. As for using this upgrade, we can drag in an instance, select it, and drag over the resource into the inspector. But what if we wanted to make our own upgrade? This upgrade will just take these particles and attach it to the bullet. And while this is really simple, we can imagine this being any sort of component, or any sort of node that we want to. We'll first start by creating a new script. I'll just call mine particle bullet strategy. And inside of the script, we'll declare the class name and extend base bullet strategy. Then we'll pull in the particles that I showed before, and we'll override the apply upgrade function and first spawn the particles, then add them as a child of the bullet and set their position to the bullet's position. And for the script, we're done. We can go ahead and create a new resource and see that our particle bullet strategy shows up. I'll go ahead and save this and give it a texture and change the text. Then back inside of our main scene, I'll drag in an instance of the upgrade and drag over the resource. Then inside of the game, we can see that the upgrade works. There's definitely a lot more that you can do with this, but hopefully this gives you ideas for your own project. There's nothing stopping you from extending this base bullet strategy and adding something like a function that applies an effect whenever you hit an enemy. And for this, you could simply store the strategy on the bullet itself and apply the onHit every single time it hits an enemy. One quick thing before I end it though, I've had a few requests to open a Discord, so I am. You can find a link in the description, and that's the perfect place to ask for help if something in the video is confusing. As well as that, the project for this video was made live, and if you'd like to have notifications whenever I work on a project like this again, there's an option to get notifications when you join the Discord server. And that's all I've got. Peace.